Everybody, welcome. We're going to get started right now. Welcome to the College of Complexes. We are here at the Dapper at 2901 West Addison in Chicago, Illinois, every Saturday from 6 p.m. until 9 p.m. We have a simple format because we're simple people here at the college. The format is we'll have announcements at the beginning, and then we'll have the speaker, and after the speaker we'll have after the speaker's finished, we'll have a Q&A session with the moderator picking who's going to ask the next question. This question must be in the form of a question mark, not a comment, but it must be a question during Q&A time. And then the last part is called rebuttal or remarks time. You will have up to 5 minutes, if we have time, up to 5 minutes to give your remark or rebuttal. All right? So our speaker today is Mr. Sid Cohen. He's given a lot of presentations here. Great presenter. Here it is, meeting 3366, college regular kid Sid Cohen, who states that this is about a new type of imperialism designed to make more profits for the bankers and industrialists. Any country that gets in their way gets overthrown. Let's give a hand to Sid, but go ahead. We're going to have announcements first, though.
What about control?
All right, Jim O'Charlie, how many here are for the College of Complexes? Anybody not? Okay. Then if you haven't already done so, you can pay me the $3 to it. Is our speaker tonight. He's a stalwart of the College of Complexes and has many times addressed us without further ado. Listen to Sid.
All right, Sid.
All right, Sid.
$3.
The first thing I want to say is I'm from the CIA. Before explaining imperialism and neoliberalism, we have to see what capitalism is. There's a relation between capital and labor. Capital purchases labor, power, and labor produces commodities that capital sells for a profit. He gets his profit from the fact that out of an 8-hour day, labor only gets paid for maybe 2 or 3 hours a day. The rest is surplus value, that is profit.
No, it's not. No, it's not.
But the commodity is sold on the open market. Capital has to pay rent.
Maybe not.
He has to pay repair for forces of production and other overhead expenses. Then the middleman and the retailer has to make a profit. If he has enough workers, he makes a handsome profit. Let us say a capitalist produces shoes, but another company opens another factory nearby and also sells shoes, manufactures shoes. So-called free market, as they call it, and that's part of the free market at one time, but not anymore. But one of these capitalists wants to compete, and he goes to the bank, and he wants to borrow capital. The bank wants to see if he is solvent, to look at his books. Before long, the banker wants to sit on the board of directors of the corporation or the factory. If the factory grows fast enough and big enough, then we have a marriage of industrial and financial capital. That is, the banker gets to sit on the board of this particular company. If the shoe factory swallows enough factories, then we have monopoly. And with monopoly, we have super profits. The marriage between industrial and financial capital is what we call imperialism. In the modern age, of course, these factories have to compete with other countries. That means that they have to have sources of leather and other raw materials and cheap labor and new markets. And since factories overproduce for their own markets, since labor can never buy back what they produce, that's where profit actually comes from. The other 5 or 6 hours that they don't get paid for is where the capitalist makes his money. So they have to have constantly new sources of markets. They have to go overseas, and they have to control other countries in order to do that. It's not simply a matter of doing it in their own country. They have to go to foreign markets. And what we have after a period of time, we have competition between the different capitalist countries that produce war after a while. So we have to remember what the von Clausewitz famous dictum was, is the continuation of policy, war is the continuation of policy by other means. Corporations have to get raw materials, have to build infrastructure, railroads, roads, airports, ports, telephone services, computers, troops to guard the installations, bases and barracks for the troops and weapons, and a puppet government to keep the masses in line. So in order to keep the masses in line, you have to have something else. And you have to have what they call a state. A state is organs of coercion, and they need troops for that. That's another reason why they need forts and everything, in order to bring in the troops. And then you have what they call the Commodore capitalist. That is the capitalist in foreign countries that works for the imperialist countries. He makes a good profit as long as he keeps his workers in line. And so, actually, what he does, it cooperates with the foreign powers, like the United States, France, England, and other countries. If the imperialist power bought raw materials at world prices, paid the workers a living wage, and brought in goods for a reasonable price, there will not be super profits. We have to know that these imperial powers have to compete with all the other powers for raw materials. So in a way, what happens is, in order to compete with raw materials, they have to build all this infrastructure. And in a way, these third world powers, after a while, gets something good done for them. It helps to develop their economy to a certain degree. But at the same time, it helps to exploit labor more. So if one looks at the internet, you can find how the CEO of one corporation sits on the board of another corporation and financial institutions and other conglomerates, then into government services. How senators and congresspeople become lobbyists for corporations. If we look at the Clinton cabinet and the Obama cabinet, it's almost a retard. And before Obama became president, he had to be vented by the Pritzker family and by Goldman Sachs. Otherwise, he never would have got in. If he was really a liberal or progressive, They never would have picked them to be the president of the United States. One of the reasons they picked him, because he was a minority, and that's one of the ways of to keep minorities in place. They think that their man is going to help them. So he talked about hope and change, but he never really had a program. If you look at Dennis Kucinich when he ran, he had a particular program. He was a real social democrat, more or less like Bernie Sanders is now. So that's the way they pacified the workers. The U.S. came out of the Second World War as the hegemonic power in the world economy. The war had lifted us out of the Great Depression. By the needed effective demand in the form of endless orders for war material and munitions, ships, planes, troops that had to be fitted with uniforms, with shoes, with barracks and so forth. That's one of the ways we got out of the Depression. Actually, Roosevelt actually didn't get us out of the Depression completely. It was about, I think about 1937 or so, after his New Deal, that the economy started to slide down again. And that's one of the ways that we got out of the Depression through the Second World War. In 1944, industrial production jumped by 90%. At the immediate end of the war, due to the destruction of European and Japanese economies, the U.S. accounted for over 60% of the world's manufacturing output. There was a very palpable fear at the top of society as the war came to an end. As the war came to a close, was that of a reversion to pre-war situation in which the domestic command would be inefficient to absorb the enormous and growing potential of economic surpluses generated by the production system, thereby leading to a renewed condition of economic stagnation. And depression. So Assistant Secretary of State Dean Acheson declared November 1944 before the Special Congressional Committee on Post-War Economic Policy Planning that if the economy slipped back where it was before the war, it seemed clear they are in for a real bad time so far as the country is concerned. We cannot go through another 10 years at the end of the 20s, like at the end of the 20s. Dedicated to the end of the 20s. So that's when they got into a different type of situation. Dedicated to the imperial control of world markets and fighting the Cold War with its headquarters in the Pentagon. The sales effort and the military-industrial complex constitute two main surplus absorption mechanisms beyond capital consumption and investment. In the U.S. economy, in the first quarter century after the Second World War. Before the First World War, Germany had only a few colonies in Africa. But to compete with Britain and France, Russia, Britain had India, Canada, the Caribbean islands, etc. France also had plenty of colonies. Russia had vast colonies in the Caucasus, Poland, and other spheres of influence. Then the U.S. had the Philippines, Cuba, and other parts of Central America. This was before the First World War. So after what happened was you had inter-imperialist rivalry set off the First World War. Not the assassination of a prime minister, of a prince in Sarajevo. This caused World War I. Germany had 70 million people with more industrial power than Britain, France, and Russia combined, and hardly no colonies.
I'll be right there, Don.
All large capitalists became imperialists, France, Germany, and the United Kingdom. The Netherlands, Japan, Belgium, Spain, Portugal, Russia. It's in the very nature of capitalism. The industries overproduce commodities when the consumers cannot buy back what has produced because they are exploited. These countries have to look for new markets, sources of raw material, cheap labor. The competition between them causes wars. Like von Clausewitz said, it's the continuation of policy by other means. If we look at the First and Second World War, we see Germany in the First World War. The reason it went to war was way down on the totem pole. After the war, Britain, France, and the U.S. were the leading imperialist powers. Russia had the Bolshevik Revolution, and a new correlation of forces had developed. Due to the Versailles Treaty, reparations had to be passed. The Allied powers in Germany went to an extremely high inflationary period. During this time, the 1930s, in the Weimar Republic, a class war broke out. The fascists, the communists, and the social democrats vied for supporters. A small sect, the Nazis, in the beer halls for their meetings, the communists organized the workers in the factories. And the social democrats who were in the social democrats, mostly they wanted a revolution, but they did not want a revolution. They wanted to reform the capitalism. But much like FDR and the New Deal, social security, less working hours, vacations, better conditions on the job, less hours of work, better pay, socialized Medicare, not to change the structure of society. No ending of capitalist exploitation of the workers. So the social democrats would not form a united front against fascism. And that's one of the reasons why you had the war. Who started the Cold War? It was not Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill started talking about the Iron Curtain. But the Cold War began in 1917, actually, after the Russian Revolution. During the Second World War, the U.S. had investments in Germany, and such investments was IBM under CEO Mr. Watson. The Nazis used the IBM machines to find where the Jews lived in Europe at that particular time. After the Second War, Second World War, not one city was bombed, but Europe was in ruin. Not after the Second World War, not one city was bombed where the difference of the corporations had some of their factories, like Ford and so forth, in Europe. So after the Second War, they had the Marshall Plan. In the Marshall Plan, American investments like General Electric, Ford, IBM, and other American firms, plus Chase Manhattan Bank, J.C. Morgan, and other capital entities, controlled a lot of the industry after the Cold War in Europe. That's one of the reasons they went in there. Of course, fascism was defeated. The USSR lost some 20 million people. All their industry was destroyed, especially in the west of the country. So again, like the First World War, the Allies won. But the U.S. came out the leading imperialist power, and the Cold War took over, and industry boomed. And of course, we had turndowns in the economy at different periods during that particular time. In 2008, we went into a deep recession, which we are still in. Let's go into neoliberalism. What is meant by this term? It's that the third world countries liberalize their economies so capital can move in freely and take over these economies. And what it does, it comes in there and says, well, we'll put money into your economy, but first you have to do certain things. You have to privatize a number of things and allow Western capital to come in and control it. Actually, that's like what we have in Chicago here. We have the schools being taken over by neoliberalism, that is to privatize things. And then they, tremendous profit, super profits. A good book on the subject is John Perkins' I Was an Economic Hitman. He goes into the fact that the third world tries to sell them on different projects. Like if you borrow capital from a certain bank, on the World Bank, and build infrastructure, the capitalists will get wealthy and help the country to develop. Loans will be about $1 billion or so. The country or the corporate capital borrows the capital and states and starts construction. They find out that they have overruns, so they need more capital. So the interest on the loan goes up, and before what happens, the interest keeps going up and going up, but the principal stays the same. So in the long run, what happens is that these people keep paying and paying and paying, and never get out of debt. That's what happened in Chile, that's what happened in Brazil, that's what happened in Argentina, that's what happens throughout the world by the so-called privatization or neoliberalism. Or they took over the waterworks or the railroad. The IMF says, we will sell the utility to an American corporation and we'll forgive some of the debt. The American corporation takes over and lays off half the workers and then increases the price for the water, telephone services, railroad tickets. The country is in worse condition than before and has less capital than before.
I've heard that.
Under Milton Friedman and the Chicago Boys, Chile had the most democratic system in South America. They never had a dictatorship there until Anaconda Copper and Rockefeller interest came in and turned into a neoliberal paradise, all to make super profits. So what is neoliberalism in the word world fascism and world domination for the banksters and the corporations? Is it inherent in the DNA of capitalism? In November 8, 2013, speech at the IMF, Larry Summers suggested that the U.S. might be stuck what he correctly called secular stagnation, described by Bloomberg Business Week as a slump that is not the product of the business cycle, but a more or less permanent condition. Summers' conclusion was deeply pessimistic. If he is right, the economy is incapable of producing full employment without financial bubbles and massive stimulus of both. Or both, which tend to end badly. The speech got a lot of attention. Summers, after all, had been the U.S. Treasury Secretary and is noted as one of the smartest, if not the political economist around. He has accepted many millions from major financial firms. He has divided and he has lived and is widely understood as a Wall Street strict oriented policymaker. Therefore, important people take his analysis very seriously. It is also a powerful indication, not simply of financial capitalism, but of capitalism itself. Still, the logic of its development now takes form as it does. So that's what we have today, secular stagnation. Capitalism is based on production for profit, not need. It is also based on the requirement of constant growth for profit. That is self-destruction, quite apart from things like the steady process of monopolization forming more and more oligopolies, as well as overproduction, decline of the rate of profit. These are long-run term tendencies that may be delayed but are inherent in the capitalism. Noam Chomsky, Power System 170-17, as I got here. Brought this out. Today, within the foreign policy circles, some of the sharpest establishment thinkers emphasize that the U.S. global preeminence is increasingly able to exercise its power as a sheriff only when it is backed up by the posse, represented by Western Europe, Japan, and the U.S., although still retaining global prominence, is increasingly able to exercise its power as a sheriff only when backed up by the posse, represented by Western Europe and Japan. It is thus the U.S. triad and not Washington itself directly, which is increasingly seeks to establish itself as a new governing power through political, economic, and military measures. while containing threats to its rule. By a rising China and a recovering Russia, emerging economies generally, and the global anti-neoliberal revolt based in Latin American movements towards socialism. The current world situation is unraveling. As evidence shows, it's destabilization. In the Middle East and North Africa, in the rise of the IS, Islamic State, ISIS, and the growing conflict in the U.S. and China over the South China Seas and Africa. The return of Russia as a world power manifested in dispute over the Crimea and the Ukraine, the dispute with states like Brazil, Chile, Cuba, and Venezuela. The question is not whether the world will continue to unravel, but how fast and how far it will unravel. All this highlights the potentiality of the devilish phase of imperialism. It is perhaps a reminder of the seriousness of the world situation today that the Soviet Union and the U.S. climatologists alerted in the world in the 1980s to the fact that a full-scale nuclear war would generally produce a nuclear winter, reducing the temperature of the whole continents by several degrees and possibly several tens of degrees, destabilizing most of the biosphere itself, and with it, all humanity. A war between the great powers does not appear to be imminent this time. However, the instability generated by the hyper-exploitative expansion of the imperialist world system of today, led by the U.S., which is now engaged in simultaneous military interventions and drone warfare in half a dozen countries, and is planning to spend $200 billion in a decade modernizing its massive nuclear arsenal, suggests that any number of ways in which a deadly confrontation could emerge. The responsibility of humanity under these circumstances is to confront, in Lenin's terms, the contradictions, conflicts, and convulsions, not only economical, but also political, national, etc., that are increasingly characterize our era. The meaning of fostering a more audacious global movement from below, in which the key challenge will be the dismantling of imperialism, understood as its entire basis of capitalism in our time, with its object of creating a more horizontal, egalitarian, peaceful, and sustainable social order controlled by associated producers.
Okay.
All right. We do have questions now. So, I see Don Ritchie has his hand up fast, and Dan after him.
Okay, actually, I have a question. I have remarks. Okay.
Oh, no.
Question.
I'm going to sit down when I take it because
I got a bad day. Did I take your chair?
I don't know.
Brown, I have questions.
Sit right there. Okay.
No, but I want something. Sorry.
All right. You like to get your high back chair.
It's more comfortable.
Okay, I'll.
But
it might be.
You just bring it around.
We need to get the mic.
I'll get the mic. I'll get it, bro.
I can talk pretty loud.
Let's get the microphone.
I might be able to just swing the
mic. No, just take it off, Brom.
Brom, you want me to do that?
You actually got it.
All right.
All right, Sid.
Other way. There you go. Okay.
All right. Starting time.
Okay, Sid, I got a question.
Well done.
Stand up and ask it.
I'm going to have to
get up out of that chair. Everybody can hear you even okay. Without the mic.
Yeah. All right. Listen. No, I'll sit. Listen, Sid, you were talking about, look, you were talking before about Barack Obama, and you said they picked him to be president. Yeah. Who are they?
Well, Goldman Sachs, for one.
Uh-huh.
He was vetted by Goldman Sachs.
Uh-huh.
Because to most people, he looked like he's a progressive.
Uh-huh.
But he didn't have a progressive program. What he talked about was hope and change. So just like any presidential candidate, the bankers want to have a look at him and see what he's really going to do.
Okay. And how is it that, so basically the bankers acting together decide who the next president of the United States
will be?
Is that what you're saying?
To a large
degree,
sure.
Okay. How do they make sure the people don't elect the wrong guy?
Well, that's why they vetted him.
Okay, but I mean, you get a whole bunch of people running for president, and there's voting.
I'm talking
about
the
most
main.
Most of the voters are not banking CEOs.
But who picks the ones that run?
They kind of pick the. Oh, all right, but they kind of pick themselves, you know.
Yeah, but then they, before they get in, they want to make sure what their policies are going to be. And who's going to sit on their cabinet. Look at the cabinets. Like Summers and the rest of them, they're all from banking conglomerates.
All right, Dan?
Yeah, you said that the Second World War, got the country out of the Depression.
Yeah.
Did that happen before in history? And is war the only way that the country can get out of depression?
Well, don't forget that the United States was the most developed industrial country in the world. And it's able to produce so many commodities. And if you have capitalism, the worker can never buy back what they produce. So in order to have markets, they got to compete with other countries. Like the First World War, Second World War, you had Germany, you had Britain, France, United States, Russia, and so forth. Well, Russia, not too much. But they all compete for raw materials, they compete for markets, and they want to make sure that they get markets. They have to go to war against their competitors.
So war is not the only way to get out. So war is not the only way to get out of a depression.
Well, that's the way. I'm going by what it actually is,
okay.
Not by what somebody says it is.
Okay.
And that's the way we got out of the Second World War and the First World War.
All right, Eliana.
I was there. I don't want to come in. Okay, so. Mr. Sid, who told you Putin occupied Crimea? He did not occupy Crimea. Putin did not.
I didn't say that.
Crimea, because Crimea it was Russian territory. It's not belong to Ukraine. So it's like territory of belong to Russia.
Well, that happened a few years ago when they had I forget the person's name. There was a premier of the Crimea.
Thank you.
And what happened was they overthrew him, and they brought in somebody that was a fascist.
Oh.
And people went into Crimea, and they started talking to these people, and they were very anti-Semitic, anti-communist, and everything. and the United States backed them. So that's what happened. But actually, the Crimea is the sphere of influence of Russia. It always has been, just like more or less Mexico or Canada is part of the sphere of the United States. So let's say if Russia came into Canada or came into Mexico, we'd be at war with them. What are they doing all the way from Russia coming in here? Same thing, what is NATO, which is controlled by the United States, doing all the way in the Crimea? When Gorbachev was in power, he had a deal, but it wasn't written down or anything, with Bush Sr. stating that they would no way try to go into the former Soviet republics with NATO. And here they come along to NATO. And you have to remember the Crimea is the breadbasket of that part of the world. And if the United States, let's say food corporations, control the Crimea, they can make tons of money, tons of super profits.
Yes, Mike?
Okay. I found the segment on liberalism very interesting. In Europe, they don't use the term neoliberalism. They use the term liberalism. And for example, the UMP, Sarkozy's and Chirac's party in France, they're labeled usually in our media as center right. But they say in Europe, you read the paper in France, and they say they believe in liberalism. They call it liberalism. So neoliberalism is pretty much an American term, and the connection between what we call neoliberalism over here and what they call liberalism in Europe. I'd never even thought to like make a comparison or a connection, but to your understanding, what is the connection between what's called neoliberalism over here and what they call just plain liberalism?
I think it's actually the same. Oh. If you look into the former Eastern Bloc countries like Poland, for instance, or if you look into other countries, you find Germany is building the Volkswagen there because it's cheap labor. And they try to privatize everything they can. And that's one of the things about neoliberalism is they try to privatize everything because they can't make enough profits by getting new markets constantly because the new markets aren't there anymore. The world is divided between mostly the United States and its satellites like Britain, France, and Japan and so forth. United States is number one dog, and it's more or less divided. There's nowhere else to go. So what they do is they cut back on labor in order to produce profits. And they privatize things so they could lay people off and give labor a short shrift, shorter than before. And that's the way they're making profits.
Well, is Poland part of the EU?
Yeah.
Sure. Right, Charlie?
Yeah, Sid, there seems to be a lot of arguments among the presidential candidates about U.S. trade deals. And this one guy says they were all no good. He's going to come in and get rid of them and have real good ones. Do you believe that?
No. No, they're already there around the world. And the thing about capitalism, it always gravitates to the place where it makes the highest profit. They're not going to get out of there just because a politician tells them. They're going to get out of there when people throw them out of there.
Yes, Victor.
Yeah, there were a few parts.
Victor, go
ahead. It says here, any country that gets in their way gets overthrown.
Well, I didn't put that in there. Charlie put that in there.
Who
It's his fault.
Jazzing it up.
I was just going to say, isn't that our standard procedure in Latin America?
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
And do you have any idea when do we stop calling a dictator president, and then we call him dictator or Hitler or that?
Yeah. Well, they always try to demonize anybody they want to invade. Like Saddam Hussein, they called him another Hitler. Of course, it's ridiculous because that particular country hardly had any industry. Germany had the most developed industry of all of Europe. So how could you compare a third world country with Saddam Hussein and Hitler Germany is ridiculous.
The Great Recession in 2008 ended because of bond buying for many years of Wall Street banks and stock brokerage firms. It put trillions of dollars into printing of money, and it was given to the banks and given to stockbrokers. There's many, many rich stockbrokers on the north side now. So that money was printed, and in return, the government bought bonds from these ailing banks and stockbrokerage firms that probably should have went out of business if true free market would have happened. So that was the mechanism that got us out of the Great Depression of 2008, the last 6 or 8 years. Can you speak about that, following the money from printing it?
Well, I'm not an economist. I can't go into that too much. But if you look at the election now, we get a good idea of what's happening in the United States. You said we're out of recession. We're not out of the recession.
We're not out of it, but it's
and
stopped.
What happened is that people have to work 2 or 3 jobs and could hardly make it. And people are so disgusted. That's why you're getting a big vote for Trump and for Bernie Sanders. Because people are so disgusted with what's going on. Yeah. They're stuck in the same thing. Like you said in there, secular stagnation is taking place. There is no real change. They say 5.5-6% unemployment. But the people that are working hardly make anything. They just barely get by.
All right.
Jane Harker.
Oh, okay. Suppose by some miracle Bernie Sanders wins the election. What are 1 or 2 things he should do to try to improve or stop the new imperialism?
Well, he's not anti-imperialist, let's face it. He never brings it up, he never talks about it, so he's not anti-imperialist. But what he has to do is have a movement, I think he's trying to do that, and bring out the issues that are forefront in people's minds, like the economy, lack of health care, and housing, and so forth and so on, jobs that don't pay anything, and things of that nature, and have a movement. And this movement will bring some level of consciousness to the average person. And with that, I think they'll form a different party, a party that where the workers themselves have the control of the economy. And that'll solve the problem. But Bernie Sanders will never be able to solve the problem.
Thank you.
Yes, Tim.
Okay. You know, you talk about all the things that capitalism does and the evil corporations. What system do you replace it with?
Soviet Union. Well, it's what you have to have, a society of producers. In other words, the people that produce the commodities control the economy. Now, they tried that in the Soviet Union, and it was under control of the Communist Party. I grant you that. But they still had a form of socialism. It wasn't the best in the world. And the reason for that, Russia was the most backward industrial power in all of Europe. It had a population that hardly had, hardly could read and write. So they didn't have the background in order for the workers to take over the state. So the Communist Party took over the state. And eventually, because of a number of things, especially of surrounding the Soviet Union with bases, not allowing to get raw materials and so forth, trying to suppress it for all those years, that it fell apart after a while, and new class of capitalists came into power. But what happens in every walk of life, what happens is you make a mistake, but the mistake doesn't stay a mistake. What you try to do is find out what caused the mistake and try to overcome it. It's a contradiction that has to be overcome so you could go to a higher level of society. So we know what happened to the Soviet Union, and we could use that as a base in order to develop a higher form of society where the producers or the workers actually control that society.
But so you're basically saying that if the Soviet Union had a class of producers who produce things directly to the consumers, that it would be a much better society, correct?
Well, that's what they had to begin with, but they didn't have optimal conditions in the Soviet Union. They had very bad conditions.
Well, didn't we have that in the American West, too, and through the big corporations of railroads and property rights that we were able to overcome
it? What built the United States, I think he brought it out, the Empire of Cotton. What they done is they used that as a means of producing capital by having slave labor, and then by using that capital from slave labor, they were able to manufacture goods and stuff like that, and that's what brought up the American colony. And then they had the Indians in the West who they committed genocide against, got rid of them, and they went west. So it was you can't compare Russia with the United States. Completely different conditions. Under different circumstances completely.
Okay.
Yes, there were different. Bill, who went?
Do you want to take from the rich and give to the poor, or would you rather keep them from getting it in the first place?
What you do is take the factories and the things that produce wealth from the rich, and you give it to people that work for a living and deserve it.
Maybe they have to do it themselves.
Of course. Nobody gives it to them.
Okay.
Right.
Take
it.
Yeah,
that's
take
the
it. Problem. Peter? Who are the imperialist countries of today?
Well, United States, Germany, France, Japan,
England.
Yeah. It's a, actually,
China?
No, Russia doesn't have no colonies. Where's its colonies?
Syria.
Germany exploits
Chechnya.
Eastern Europe
Central Asia.
Under the European Union. If you somebody brought up something here about 2 or 3 weeks ago, maybe a month ago, and it showed about the Eastern Soviet bloc countries, and they were the lowest on the rung of economic security of all those countries. So Germany is exploiting them.
So is war inevitable under imperialist countries?
Yeah, definitely.
So when does it happen?
It's happening now.
Where?
Afghanistan, Pakistan, Libya,
Iraq. Yemen, Somalia. Wherever.
Well, okay. Victor?
Yeah. I really was kidding myself there for a while. I thought that with Obama and Hillary, we were less imperialist. And until this fiasco in Honduras sort of changed my mind. It's it seems like we really still favor or will try to change things for our own likes or dislikes instead of the whatever's
best for the overall society, for the majority.
Yeah, well, they invaded the Honduras, I think it was about 5 years ago, and Hillary Clinton was Secretary of State, and they overthrew a legally elected government, and now that country is having mass murders there and everything else, and they have all kinds of gangs that came in from the United States. It's a madhouse.
Well, let's see. Peter has a question. How are we doing for time?
It is right now 7:33, and we got some time left.
6:30.
7:30, Sid.
It's the new time.
Okay.
It's the
new time.
I'm sorry.
Imperialist countries used to fight each other. Is that over with? Are they all on the same team to exploit the third world?
Well, it seems the United States has control of all those other countries. So for the time being, that's what it is. They're fighting third world countries.
Okay, Dan.
Yes, Dan.
All right, I have a question about medical tourism. People in America are going to India, Hungary, France, Canada, Mexico for medical. Is this part of the breakdown of the American capitalism? People charging too much, and the Republicans say they're going to get rid of Obamacare and replace it with something better. Do you believe any of that?
No. Actually, Obamacare, it's a capitalist type of program, and what it's doing is making the insurance companies rich, and it's bringing a few more people into the medical system that couldn't afford it before. I'm not saying it's not valuable, but what you need is like they have in other industrialized countries, like a system like they have in Canada, you know, things of that nature.
But even in Canada, France, Germany, people pay something for their insurance, health insurance.
Yeah.
It's not totally free.
No, of course, it's not socialized medicine.
Well, it's been socialized in some ways, but... Do you think we will overcome those insurance companies and pharmaceuticals and have a single payer? Is there a chance?
Yeah, single payer would be the best, as far as I could see.
But there is no chance of overcoming those institutions.
Not now. Now we have to watch out for fascism, because I think that's what the... Trump is advocating.
Yes.
I
have a question.
Sid,
do you think that Soviet Russia will move to single payer?
I have no idea. I don't know what's happening.
Oh, all right, yes. Don.
All right, Sid, you were talking about you kind of view imperialism as pretty much a capitalist phenomenon. Well, I wanted to ask you what you think about communist imperialism, for example, the Soviet Union taking over, establishing these puppet governments in Mongolia, Poland, and East Germany, and North Korea, and so on and so forth, and Afghanistan, one in Afghanistan too for a while, and you talk about the exploitation of workers as something that only occurs under capitalism. Well, I mean, I think that anybody who's ever lived in the Soviet Union can tell you that the workers are exploited like crap, and they were exploited like crap in the Soviet Union. So what do you say about that?
For one thing, the Soviet Union was never imperialist in the terms that I was talking about, where it extracts super profits from these other countries. And that's what imperialism is all about. It's monopolization of the corporations. And what it had there was certain countries in the Eastern Bloc were more advanced than the Soviet Union was. Like if you take Czechoslovakia and if you take Eastern Germany, They weren't exploited. But the thing is that they were surrounded by capital states and had to spend a lot of money on protecting themselves against these capital states. And they didn't have the latest technology that the United States and France and England had. So they were handicapped in a lot of ways, but they weren't imperialistic.
The Soviet Union always said officially that they were assisting the workers in these other countries with their homegrown revolutions. Do you agree with that?
Yeah.
So what happened to Solidarno?
Well, you see what happened to Lech Walesa. He became a tool of the capitalists. They took over, and that's what you got there.
Does that mean that Solidarno was counter-revolutionary?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
You're right. If only Walesa and the other workers had just kept their nose on the grindstone and did as they were told, then they'd all be better off under the guidance of their masters.
But I should remind you that one fool left.
You're right. You're absolutely right.
All right. Any more questions,
all
Brian?
Right. If there are no further questions, we will move to the rebuttal period.
Let's see what Speaker said.
Remember that Sid is getting the final rebuttal.
Okay.
All right. I'll get that microphone.
Maybe you should get a whiskey.
And you all sat there, good sir. And I'll take the first rebuttal. Of course.
So it couldn't call
my call nice microphone job. And it's called microphone prerogative. exercising a little bit of my influence. Come on up, Bill. Come on up, Bill.
Well, you tell me.
All right, let me get this secure here, and we will get on our way.
I'm gonna have to take this home.
You know, Sid, I don't think I've heard of a more crazier antic tonight than what I've seen before, because I know that capitalism actually works. When you empower poor people with the right to buy and sell, that's when prosperity starts. Not just in an informal extra-legal market where the government won't let them organize or run their businesses, but when they can actually buy and hold title to property, when they can actually get the capital goods that they don't have access to because it's not properly titled. And this is not me talking, this is a gentleman from the Institute of Liberty and Democracy who's ran several of these types of initiatives around the world. You start seeing prosperity, because what happens is when a poor person can actually get access to his capital, meaning he can mortgage his home, he could buy property, have legal title to it, not have it subject to government confiscation because of some obscure law that says somebody else owes it, has a proper identity like an address and is able to do such things like get a credit card, get actually billed for utilities, and have a clean banking and money system, you know, you'll actually find that capitalism actually works. And that a market is actually a functioning deal. Because what happens is that what determines production is actually prices. When a commodity is in high demand, it has a high price, more people go into it and make it. When a commodity has a low price, there's actually people who get out of the business and get into something else. It's a lot of dislocation, it's a lot of things along the lines where there's constant change and fluidity, but it works. We have seen in the United States, just for example, just with this internet revolution and connectivity with computers, just over the last 30 years, how good the system can be. Granted, we've lost some manufacturing jobs, but you know something, Sid? There's a lot more coming back. And a lot of that's got to do with the low energy prices due to fracking and and the low price of oil and some other stuff along these lines. The thing is that when you have legal title to property, when you have rule of law, and you have a basic amount of freedom,
That's going to guarantee prosperity, not some government program, not some changing of the things. And if you want a workers' control of the corporation, well, you can do it. Just have the workers buy stock in their local corporation and put them on the board of directors. Or the whole thing can go in. There's a lot of ways to get corporate governance. Now, these super hyperinflated capitalists, I will admit, what you're talking about is mercantilism. Even our favorite capitalistic guy who wrote the book in 1776 called The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith also rallied against monopolistic practices. We have something in this country called the antitrust laws. They have not been put to active and good use yet. Yes, banks are too big to fail. Yes, they're too things to crazy, but I have to say it. The government can do something. It's called letting big banks go bankrupt and using some of the antitrust laws to fix the problem. We don't need to scrap the system. We will have long-term prosperity. Remember, the United States is a global empire. You keep the sea lanes open, you keep the goods a flowing, and you keep globalization a growing.
Yes.
I've been going to college long enough to understand that there's quite a few people here that believe in taking from the rich and giving to the poor. Well, that's a ploy that creates its own problem, because how did the rich get it in the first place? It's counterfeiting a serious crime. They do it through a central bank. John Maynard Keynes wrote a very elegant passage, a couple pages, in the Economic Consequences of the Peace, a 1919 book, on how this happens. And that becomes the way of distributing wealth. It creates its own problem. It's a big con job by the rich to get you guys singing their tune. I think we ought to get rid of central bank, and we ought to get rid of the income tax.
Bitcoin. No income tax.
Well, Bitcoin is easily—it's not like a commodity currency. It's something that can easily be created about like creating paper money. But if you consider counterfeiting a serious crime. Well, let's stop the big counterfeiters.
Yay! Stop the big counterfeiters.
Sid, I thought it was a great talk, very interesting. I do want to acknowledge that, we got a capitalistic system, but there are people who benefit, and I'm actually one of them. I worked hard all my life. Hey, we all worked hard all your life. But I wound up with a pension. I worked my butt off, but I have had an excellent retirement. So I certainly have personally benefited with minimal capacity. So there are exceptions to the rule. Now, I put some articles there about the Nordic states, and they are capitalistic. So you got five small countries that are capitalistic countries, and although Sid said their workers are being exploited, they're a very equal, all of them. If you look at the equality index, they're all high on equality. They got good equality, they've got reasonably good freedom, and they've got very good prosperity, all with capitalism. Now, somebody would say, well, they don't have any armies. Yes, we're dumb enough to provide the armies for them. And if you want to read something about that from a different point of view than Sid's, look at American Umpire, not Empire, American Umpire by Elizabeth Cobb Hoffman. And it's a different point of view than Sid's. I don't agree with her, but it's an excellent book, and I certainly would recommend it. I do also want to mention about the hyperinflation in 1923 in Germany. I'm sure there is a better source, but if you read the section in A Force More Powerful by Ackerman and Duval, it'll explain that hyperinflation in Germany in 1923, something I hadn't read anywhere else. Thank you.
Yay. Okay. 5 minutes.
All right.
5 minutes.
Five.
Yes.
All right. I'll take 5 minutes.
Only
sip
five.
It, strip it on.
You got enough time tonight.
It's not enough.
All right. You know, we start taxing the 1% properly, a lot of these problems go away.
Yeah.
So, $18 trillion in debt is just nuts. $500 billion a year going to interest. It's nuts. And it's people making $500 billion on interest. Yeah, you know, some of these points here on the American worker has gotten screwed. I mean, just screwed. I mean, between globalization, which drives wages down.
Can you get a container for it, please?
Down, I'll wait until you get your tapioca sugar out.
It's rice pudding.
Rice pudding.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, since globalization drives wages down, deunionization drives wages down, mechanization, computerization drives wages down. So, be a stockbroker. They got trillions of dollars given to them in the last several years. Taxpayer dollars. Printed. Anyway, that's what I got to say about the American workers. You know, we're still in imperialistic wars. The ISIS, we're still in the Iraq war, everybody. The Iraq, Halliburton, Cheney oil war. Because that's what ISIS is. It's Iraq army, along with God knows how many other people causing havoc. And what are we going on with 2003? It's 13 years of an Iraq Cheney Halliburton oil war. Just so we could have cheap gasoline and jet fuel. So, you know, yeah, another problem is Tim thinks that mechanisms are in place to dissolve monopolies or not let them happen. I mean, even railroads get monopolized. There are four positions on the monopoly board, for Bevan's sake. And I was at a railroad meeting again last night where Canadian Pacific wants to take over, who is it, CSX or Norfolk Western? Norfolk Southern. So, you know, with Wall Street that's owning Washington and all the agencies, it's a no wonder. It's no wonder the EPA can't work, or the people that keep an eye on monopolies can't work well. So sometimes I think you need a Donald Trump that just kicks some ass.
Jesus.
What?
Even though he's kind of nuts.
No.
All right. Who voted for Bernie? Raise your hands.
No.
For what?
Bernie.
No.
Yeah. Well, hold him up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Who voted for Hillary?
No. Zero.
Yeah. One, okay. Just one.
No.
Who voted for Trump? We're not going to say anything.
Yeah.
Really? One, two, three? No, three no, Trumps? No. Who voted for Kasich, the warmonger?
No way.
Okay, one. That's one,
two.
Two.
How many voted for Cruz?
Cruz.
Rafael.
No.
Rafael Eduardo Cruz.
One vote for Rafael, huh?
Voted for everything. Oh,
Canadian.
Hey, 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 this is all Chicago. Right.
Vote early and vote early and vote often. This is Chicago.
Anybody not vote? Last time I asked, five people didn't even vote.
What about you?
I went with Bernie. I felt the burn. Keep the heat on Hillary.
I still like Trudeau myself.
We got to keep the heat on Hillary, the Wall Street girl. Hillary.
I still like Justin Trudeau myself.
Thank you.
I love Newsberry.
Trudeau's great. Bernie. I just have a couple of very brief comments. Sid, I liked your talk, generally speaking. I agree with a lot, as I usually do with socialists. But I think the socialists have a very serious weakness, and that is that they don't look at the political system very carefully. Tim asked what system should replace the current system, and that is the capitalist system. And you didn't really, I don't think, answer that question. In the Soviet Union, you kind of defended it. The Communist Party and the Soviet system were rank tyranny, just a hellish tyranny. Millions of peasants were killed, starved to death in the Ukraine and other places because of bad, terrible economic policies. There were millions stuck in hellish camps, work camps in Siberia, almost as bad as the Nazi concentration camps in many ways. So there are different kinds of tyranny. Our political system in the United States and other Western countries is one type of tyranny, masquerading as democracy, a quote-unquote representative system. But the Soviet Union and historical communist systems were a different kind of tyranny. Workers were exploited in maybe different ways, but it was still exploitation. So you have exploitation not just in pure capitalist systems. The workers, you said, the workers should control society. Well, historical communist systems are the last places on earth where the workers actually control society.
All right, well, I'm gonna act like a true person of the 20th century and stand up here staring at my cell phone instead of doing anything else, as to demonstrate that I am truly a person of the modern world. No, just kidding. Actually, I was just turning my phone off so I don't get any phone calls while talking. All right, I thought this was a real interesting presentation, Sid. I was going to say a lot of what Ted said. Ted, you kind of stole my thunder. As I think I mentioned in one of my questions, I mean, there was a great deal of, I mean, I noticed that you kind of changed the definition of imperialism. Traditionally, people would say imperialism is when you create an empire, when you go out and conquer other countries and make colonies out of them, or in the modern way, you create puppet states. Well, the Soviets, both the United States and the Soviets have done that. I think the United States has done it more than the Soviets, but the Soviets still did it too, and I mentioned some of those countries already. Ted has already talked about how the workers were exploited under communism. Now, Sid, you claimed that there wasn't any kind of extraction of the wealth of the country when the Soviets took over a country like, let's say, East Germany. Well, as a matter of fact, in East Germany, they effectively deindustrialized East Germany and moved much of the factories that took them apart and relocated them to the Soviet Union. They considered that a form of reparations. Now, I mean, maybe that was justified. Nevertheless, that is an extractive act. Now, a second thing that you, on the subject of imperialism, Russia's a lot today is a lot smaller than they were in the old days, but they haven't quite given up the imperialist game. Just as an example, Crimea, which came up earlier this evening, was part of Ukraine until just a few years ago when Russia took it over. Now, and they pretty much took it over by force, took it away from the Ukrainian government. Now, Sid, you also mentioned that you said that there was an unspoken agreement between the U.S. and Russia during the administration of George W. Bush, that the U.S. would not extend its influence into the former USSR. Well, I don't know if such an agreement existed. I never heard of that before, but I can tell you that during that time, during the Bush years, the U.S. had made allies out of Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia, all of which are former Soviet republics. The U.S. also extended its influence to Georgia and Azerbaijan, but those are also former Soviet republics, mm-hmm. and we also made an ally out of, and we even had troops in Uzbekistan and Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan, which we used as a launching base for our invasion of Afghanistan in 2001. So the United States was expanding into the former Soviet Union. Now, I started thinking, since you said Saddam Hussein cannot be compared to Hitler, and a few years ago I would have agreed with you, but it suddenly occurred to me that there is a parallel. Both Saddam and Hitler were totalitarian dictators, and both carried out genocide against minority groups that they didn't like. In the case of Hitler, it was against the Jews and the Gypsies and the Jehovah's Witnesses. In the case of Saddam, it was against the Kurds in northern Iraq. How much time have I got left, Tim?
About a minute or two.
Okay, I just wanted to say, so I noticed that while Sid was, did anybody turn this beeping sound off? I noticed that while Sid tried to go easy on Russia, I noticed that you present the United States as worse than it really is. For example, you make it sound like some cabal of bankers gets together and decides who the next president will be, what actually happens is that we have an election and all the eligible voters elect the new president. And the second thing is, you're talking about Bernie Sanders, and you said Bernie Sanders never talks about foreign policy. It's not true. He doesn't bring the subject up on his own very much, but when people ask him about it in the presidential debates, which I've watched, he does bring it up. And his views are pretty similar to those of Hillary Clinton, as a matter of fact, on foreign policy. So, okay, well, I guess that's all I have to say today.
All right.
Hi there, my name's Mark, and this is my first time here, and you're going to have to excuse me, because to see my notes, I have to have my glasses on, which means I can't see anybody else. Wanted to bring up a couple things. Sid, that was a great presentation. To begin with, the Soviet Union was not a socialist or was not a communist country. It was state capitalism. The ownership of the factors of production was the state. Under real Marx, and even Lenin said during the revolution that we're not done, and he was striving to get the country to that point. But then when Stalin took over, he declared victory and said that state capitalism is in fact Marxism, which it wasn't. He was just trying to declare victory. And yes, that was a brutal authoritarian regime. But real Marxism is much like entrepreneurial worker-owned capitalism. Under Marxism, the workers, the people that produce the surplus, own the companies. So that surplus that labor creates flows back to labor, so you don't have class distinction. And that's what we need to do in this country to fix things, because we used to have an egalitarian society. We were approaching it with the changes under FDR, and now we're so far from that. We have, the 0.1% that exploit everybody else. And the other thing I suspect is the capitalists are not going to go quietly into the night. We're going to have this massive homeland security apparatus that we created since 9/11 is going to be turned back onto the American people in probably a brutal fashion. As we've also seen, there's been a horrific blackout against Bernie Sanders. So when we talked about, who elects the president, here you have a progressive candidate who's gotten like 1/10 the amount of press time and attention.
Not even a tenth.
Not even a tenth of the other candidates. So in fact, though, I do want to urge everybody, if anybody wants to help on the Bernie campaign, you could go to his website, log in, make phone calls from home into some of those states out west that are still having primaries, and try to stop Shillery, the corporate shill. Anyway, the other paradox coming that I think we're going to have something that's going to transcend both capitalism and actually, you know, socialism and Marxism is we're developing artificial intelligence. And when, you know, years ago I was once at a steel company and there were 10,000 workers, and then they built a new factory and there was 200 workers. Well, with automation, computer intelligence, one of the things that's been happening is every time one of these new technologies comes about, we replace it with less workers, not more. And I think we can get to a point, you know, there's this dread of this age of robots coming, but when you think about that for a second, you know, robots don't shop. What does that mean when all of a sudden that you have factories and factories without a single human living person there? We're going to have to rejigger our whole social economic system to create some kind of universal income for everybody, because we really could produce without the need for workers. So that's about my comments. Thank you.
Yay.
It's an open mic.
Yeah, I must have heard it like you knew what you were talking about. Boy, you did noise. Alright, thank you very much, Sid, for putting together a nice program there. I don't know what more I can contribute, but I'll just a few comments on what I've heard thus far. I've said it before, I've heard some things here. Labor creates all wealth. Labor creates all factories in which that wealth is produced. And Tim, I don't understand, if the workers built the factory, why they should pay someone for their own factory that they built. There's a big building downtown that belongs to this guy running for President, Trump. And if we want that building, he did nothing, as far as I can perceive, to build that building. He didn't put in one nail or put in any cement or anything or any effort or carpentry or plumbing. So I don't understand why, if we want that building, we should give him money for it when he did nothing towards its existence. This is silly. I went through this Ford factory up in Detroit, and the person taking me on the tour said, Henry Ford built this factory, and it expands for 5 miles. I said, that's amazing. He could do that. He did that, right? No, I think about 5,000 guys, 10,000 guys did it. So what is this thing here about who owns the means of production? Now, the other thing I'm leading to is I don't know why we should compensate and continue to compensate the CEOs when they apparently don't do anything towards wealth creation. What value is added to the process by a CEO? Now, he's claimed that factories or organizations cannot operate without them, which is not necessarily the case. And an economy can certainly operate without them. I don't see if they're total necessity. There once was a factory here in Chicago where there was a severe snowstorm. Had quite a sizable installation, and curiously enough, no one in the management staff came in to work that day, or at least that morning. And yet the factory was operating at its normal capacity. Do you think the average person employed in some factory is what, like, incapable of thought or concept? Do you think this restaurant cannot operate unless the cooks and the waitresses and the busboy have some authoritarian figure, they certainly, I think, know how to do it, and probably could do it much better very often with the interference of some authority figure here who operates towards their own end. Now, the last thing I want to know, we're talking about international thing, there's two questions. I shouldn't end on a question, but Tim, if this system of globalization brings so much prosperity, I was wondering, and perhaps you can answer this later, why has it not brought any prosperity? I'm keeping reading about this all the time to the people employed in Bangladesh. Why is, as a matter of fact, it seemingly has gotten worse. You could have a compelling thing. What is going on here? And the other question is, and I've got to ask you why this international trade and laws of it, why in the world do they pick up a factory and move it intact to another country? That makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. Now, there's something inherently wrong with the system that says the people of this country can't operate. They're doing the same thing the people operating these factories.
That's right.
So why in the world, in your system, do we have this endless movement and disturbance? I don't know. It's producing this. The factory is producing precisely the same thing it was here as it will over here. So what is it that you're achieving by moving it? The goods are not any better. I'll tell you what it is changes, though, is that the lives of the people that produce those goods are what? Not better. Thank you. That's why they move it. So they can screw somebody.
After Randy goes, I'll answer the question.
Yeah, to cheat somebody.
You know, Trump broke the ground with
this. In essence, your system is theft.
One fool at a time.
Yeah, give me your money. Yeah, give me your stuff.
Okay, good evening. I'll try to make my comments as coherent as possible. As usual, it's like trying to cram 50 pounds of potatoes into a 5-pound sack. You always forget something. I'd like to congratulate the college for the assemblage of people we have here, because week after week, the college shows us one of the primary facts that I work with daily. I'm in the reality-based community. The college shows us just how far out of touch with observable reality people can be on different subjects. Some people are very well versed on one thing, but they're living in a bubble of fantasy land on another subject.
Yep. That's true.
And that's because knowledge moves forward from person to person. It doesn't spread through the population all at the same time. That's why you can have some people that think there's absolutely no problem with Catholic priests in the Catholic Church, even though the Academy Award-winning movie Spotlight just got the award for Spotlight was the investigative team from the Boston Globe that talked about the decades of cover-up and why editors missed it or didn't want to, you know, it's human nature not to want to face a reality that is too bad to think about. I'm producing a new series of articles. The main one is called Facts Without Politics. If you start with a fact that everybody can agree on, it's only when it becomes politicized that in America, certain facts are presented to the public as political opinion.
Right.
And if you're not from that political party, you can just ignore that fact. It doesn't exist. So, Michael Moore's new movie is being subjected to a total blackout, the same as Bernie Sanders, because Michael Moore's movie is about Bernie Sanders' campaign without saying it that much. Moore visits other countries, he invades other countries and plants the American flag and steals an idea from them and brings it back to America without killing anybody. That's the essence of the movie. And at the end of the movie, he says, all these ideas, good things happening in other countries, they once originated in America, and these countries stole them from us. Well, nobody's asking the question in the media, why is America, number one, we're the only country on the planet that is producing debt slaves among students who are trying to get credit hours in college.
That's correct.
You know, kids come out of college 30 years in debt, yep, if they can pay it off. It's like a mortgage payment for the rest of their lives just to get the credit hours. Nobody is asking the question, why are we not questioning the welfare for billionaire system that this country is running? The welfare that goes to the people at the bottom is 0.1% of the welfare that is shoveled to the top 0.1% of the people. Nobody's asking the question, how is it that one family, Walmart, the one Walmart family owns as much wealth as the bottom half of America? What's wrong with that picture, people?
Yeah,
you have Zeitgeist, the movie, is one thing. You can watch it free on the internet. Zeitgeist, Addendum is the name of it. There's another movie out, mentioned Zeitgeist. I think Tim mentioned Tomorrowland, a Disney movie. It talks about what the world could be like.
That was me.
I'm sorry, not Tim.
Don.
That's Don over here. Sorry about that. Anyway, Don mentioned, and I've told a bunch of people, Tomorrowland is one of the best things you can see. The thing about what would the human race look like if people started to think positive and think outside the box. And not, we still have people that think that hydraulic fracturing is giving us some form of energy, when hydraulic fracturing is destroying the water table and creating a new gold rush in water. Some of the best minds that have no ethics, no morals and conscience are going into the water business. What happened in Flint, Michigan is just the tip of the iceberg of what's coming with profiteering corporations wanting to make profits off clean air, clean water, this kind of stuff. Give me just one final thought.
Go ahead, Andy.
Yeah. I would suggest that everyone simply log on, if you have internet access, start watching the news on Common Dreams. CommonDreams.org is at the top of the list of many different organizations that show news without the junk food news. You want to know what's happening in the United States, around the world, start logging on to Common Dreams, because you'll get links to hundreds of other sources all over the world of good stuff. And you can follow Bernie's campaign, which is picking up speed, incidentally. Bernie is not behind. He's right on schedule. Yeah. Hillary peaked as of March 15th. Hillary states peak for her, and then the states that favor Bernie are coming up. And that was written 3 weeks before. You know, the press is just force-feeding us Hillary all the time. And it doesn't have to be that way, people. But we have to face reality. Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
All right, I'm going to answer Charlie's question.
Okay, Charlie, we're going to try to answer your questions.
Okay.
Bangladesh and the workers there. The first thing you have to understand is that Bangladesh has now got factories. They now have jobs that have brought them off the peasant farm. And as the workers are doing their organizing, much like we did with the right after the Triangle Shirtwaist fire, they're going to start seeing their wages rise. Now, that might mean that some of the low-cost clothing factories might move to other low-wage countries, but they too will then organize and bring their wages up. There's stuff people saying right now that China's getting a little bit too expensive for some of the goods produced, so they're moving to Vietnam and other low-wage countries. To me, it's a good thing. The difference between what you see with a shirt made in the U.S. and a shirt made in Bangladesh is price. We all have a closet full of shirts now instead of one
two or three shirts. Nobody says when we have a bunch of low-priced goods and a good way of living with a good clean flow of the sea lanes, everything. Nobody thanks global capitalism for the low pricing and the interconnections we have. What Adam Smith has simply said is that if a country specializes in a certain thing, its wealth is going to increase. He said this way back in 1776, and that's exactly what's happening around the world. Now, the United States may not be the world's producer like it once was, but it certainly is and still will be the dominant power for about the next 100 years. I mentioned all this back in January, but I think when you've seen the standard of living rise, particularly in India, China, Africa, and a lot of these other places where globalization is finally getting its reach into, you're starting to see people get off of these peasant farms. You're going to see these people start to prosper. And virtually, they're saying within about a 15-year period that abject poverty can be reduced through the advance of capitalism and globalization. What's wrong is that a lot of the poor people don't have access to it. They need to reform the property laws. They need to let the poor people monetize and market their assets to a broader market. That's what's holding us back, not the monopolistic practices and things you keep talking about. Yes, there's evils in the system, but there's laws that do protect, and there are, thank God, we have organized workers and unions to hold some of this monopolistic power in check.
Well, someone this evening has lauded capitalism and as support, as an example of how capitalism works so well, has pointed out that we can charge our utility bills to credit cards.
Yes.
Okay. We can go into debt just paying our electric bill. Okay. God bless capitalism and God bless America.
And there is a process called bankruptcy. Yeah.
Which is being taken away from ordinary people.
Couple other things. You know, I think from the Republican side, you just keep austerity, and austerity is just a failed system. When somebody's out of work, they don't go buy a slice of pie. That waitress then doesn't go buy a new dress, and the whole thing just implodes. And that's this like failed Reaganism you just keep hearing about. And you know, the problem with capitalism is it generates all these selfish companies, you know, try to externalize costs. So they make money when they throw their crap into a river or into the air. They make money when they pump hydraulic, you know, chemicals into our water supply. They make money when they exploit their workers. They make money exactly with, you know, screwing the people in Michigan. And you know, it's a failing system, and you know, we live in very precarious times. When you look at the situation now, for example, just from a monetary basis, you've got all these countries, their central banks are, you know, have negative interest rates. They're trying to stimulate things so badly. But when you have all the wealth in the upper, you know, 0.1%, the poor working man has no money to go to the store and buy something. And yet, that simple fact they can't figure out, and they're too greedy to. You know, as they said about how FDR saved capitalism, they're too greedy to give some back, you know, to at least make things better. And we're just going to have these continuing boom-bust cycles until there's changes. And it's only going to get worse, like I said, with, you know, the future of robotics when even less people will be working.
I heard somebody say that we have laws, so I just want to read from this book, The Shock Doctrine, by Naomi Klein, The Rise of Disaster Capitalism, because I just heard You know, somebody say that we have laws, so, you know, I think I have a good response to that claim. This is on page 453. In March 2006, a federal jury in Virginia ruled against the company Custer's Battles, that's the name of the company of all names, finding it guilty of fraud and forced it to pay $10 million in damages. The company then asked the judge to overturn the verdict with a revealing defense. It claimed that Coalitional Provisional Authority, which was the unaccountable leadership in Iraq, was not part of the U.S. government, and therefore not subject to its laws, including the False Claims Act. The implications of this defense were enormous. The Bush administration had indemnified U.S. corporations working in Iraq with any liability under Iraqi walls. If the CPA wasn't subject to U.S. law either, it meant the contractors weren't subject to any law at all. U.S., Iraqi, or any other country on the earth. This time, the judge ruled in the company's favor. He said that there was plenty of evidence that Custer's Battles had submitted to the CPA's false and fraudulently inflated invoices, but he ruled the plaintiffs had failed to prove that the claims were presented to the United States. In other words, the U.S. government presence in Iraq during the first year of its economic experiment had been a mirage. There had been no government, just a funnel to get our taxpayer dollars, billions. And I can't imagine what $1 billion is, so if anybody afterwards would like to tell me what $1 billion is, I can't get my head around that amount of wealth. And Iraqi oil dollars to foreign corporations completely outside the law. Capitalism is not, you know, this isn't the predictable extreme end of capitalism. Capitalism is extreme in itself. So when you say, well, capitalism sometimes gets close to the slippery slope of equality, inequality, and poverty, and war, and brutality, and ecocide, and pollution, and sometimes it gets over here near the people. You know, I used to be receptive to that argument about 10 or 15 or 20 years ago until I realized, you know, it's not a slippery slope when we're in this fog of propaganda. We're already out over the cliff. We're already falling. There is no slippery slope that we're getting close to. And that's because they can, anytime they want, and we're under the watch of a good cop right now. If we were under the watch of the bad cop, we'd not be in this fog of denial and deception that somehow things are going to get better. That's what it is. It is an extreme, and, you know, any system that abolishes capitalism, you know, here, long overdue.
Okay. All right. Rob, 5 minutes.
How come you only get 5 minutes?
Everybody's been taking five.
Well, except for Andy.
Andy took six.
I'm sorry.
We gave him a little.
I was glad to hear it.
He's special.
That,
of course.
What the communists presented to the world was state capitalism. I do agree that it was state capitalism because there was a capitalist class that owned and controlled the state, and the state did have privileges for that class. But you know, separate places to shop, separate dachas, little villages, vacation places on the not the Caspian, but the Black Sea. But that's ancient history now. We now have modern, more privatized capitalists, and the state still runs everything, and the owning class still persists, only they have different connections. Well, that's in the Soviet Union. Here, capitalism works, or when it doesn't work. And for many people, and it doesn't work, and they don't work, and life is, you know, on the dole. Well, it's a market correction. But when the Soviet system, they said, well, I don't know what they called it. Was it market correction? No. They had to have corrections to a failed policy, or maybe the capitalist imperialists were conspiring against them, but they were marching on to the future, and so are we. Only the future for them was not that great, and for the much more democratic capitalism of the West, it may not be so great either. And we don't know. I wish sometimes that people who extol capitalism would just look at it a little more, you know, the objectively. CEOs and managers of the corporations conspire with some of the not too interested in the corporation traders, capitalists. Those who are in short-term investors to rip off the corporation selling off assets, and there are so many problems with our private corporate capitalism that, you know, just saying, oh, socialism will cure it all,
right.
Which socialism? And what kind of movement are you going to build? Where are you going to get a transition from one sort of exploitation to a non-exploitative society? It takes a lot of thinking, it takes a lot of work and prayer.
Okay, stay up there, Brown.
Come on for a minute, Charlie. Charlie, come on up for a minute. I want to thank all of you guys for coming tonight.
What about our speaker?
And our speaker is going to be speaking in a minute, but I personally just want to say thank all of you for coming tonight, supporting this institution. I'd especially like to say Brown for his steadfastness and coming. And congratulations for keeping our records and doing everything we need to do. And again, without all of you, this free speech forum would not exist. So thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Mr. Pontecano, a lot of you are very faithful in coming and doing what you can. None of us can do as much as we is needed for the kind of growth that we need. But
God will help us.
But I know that people are hurting, and it's everybody doesn't come up here with $3. You can't always supply that. But the fact that they came
is important.
Right. Let's welcome Sid for the last word.
All right.
And thanks to Tim for what you do for us.
All right, Sid.
Yeah.
Okay. That's right.
All right, Sid, you got the last word.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah. I think one of the problems when people talk about socialism, they think socialism has got a blueprint, and that blueprint has to be fulfilled. And if it's not fulfilled, then it's not socialism. But Marx never had a blueprint. He never talked about it. He says he don't know what socialism is going to look like. Except he looked at the Paris Commune in 1871, and he seen some characteristics in it, and he thought that would probably be a part of the characteristics. But what you have to look at, essentially, is the conditions under which you're working. And if you don't examine the conditions that you're under which you're working, you never get anywhere. If you try to achieve utopia under negative conditions, you never make it. You fall on your face. So what you do the best with what you have. And I think that's what happened to the Soviet Union. And it wasn't the expectations that a lot of people thought they would get out of it. But you have to be realistic and say, we could achieve so and so much in this time. And we have to look at the negative features and try to overcome the negative features and go forward. And so there's a lot of practice involved, a lot of struggle involved, and without the struggle, you don't get anywhere. And you say, well, Soviet Union couldn't make it, this couldn't make it, that couldn't make it, let's forget about it. But if you look at any endeavor in the world, and they're all materialist endeavors, somebody can't get over a hump, they look for different ways to overcome it, and eventually they overcome it, understand it, and get to some point where it's progress. And that's all you can hope for. If you try to get the progress right away, you fall on your face.
Yay! All right.
All right, thanks for that.
All right.
Amen, God.
No sense.
Can you get Facebook on the internet?
And that's a wrap. Again, I declare the college adjourned.
I've never tried to. Wow, you ended really strong there. That was well. And that you were ad-libbing.